It is Christmas 1941. For the people of Britain, it is the third Christmas of the war. A war of increasing hardship and deprivation. A war which had crystallized into a struggle for the survival of civilization. But Britain and the British Empire no longer oppose Nazism alone. America has been at war for less than 3 weeks. On December 7th, the Imperial Navy of Japan launched undeclared war with a massive attack upon the U.S. naval base at Pearl Harbor in Hawaii. Thousands die, and the U.S. battle fleet is destroyed. But America's carrier force escapes destruction, and in the coming year, the Japanese will regret their aggression. In the snows of midwinter, the Russian army begins its long, slow fight back with the first of a series of counterattacks that drive the invader back from the communist capital. All over the world, every worker, every machine strains to the utmost to provide the materials of war. In the battles of 1942, the struggle that encircles the earth will become greater and more destructive than ever before. January 1st, 1942, saw the United Nations Declaration. This was a grand alliance between China, the United Kingdom, the United States, and the USSR. This was the first formal alliance made by the United States since 1778. All signatories agreed to use all their strength and resources against the Axis, to cooperate with the others, to fight until the defeat of the Axis, and not to make a separate peace. The destruction of Pearl Harbor was simply the first element of a much greater Japanese strategy of invasion and expansion. An unstoppable tsunami of conquest swept across the Eastern Pacific into Southeast Asia, leaping across land and sea, skipping across the archipelagos from island to island, stepping stones to victory. The U.S. islands of the Philippines were taken by surprise only a few days following the attack on Pearl Harbor. Inexplicably, once more, U.S. aircraft were caught unawares on the ground, lined up in neat rows, making the task of the Japanese easy. With naval superiority, Japanese Marines made easy landings in both the north and south of the islands, catching the U.S. forces in the grip of a pincer movement. Quickly, 90,000 Japanese troops were in place to attack just 25,000 American defenders. Defenders who the United States could do little to reinforce or aid. The British colony of Malaya was invaded from the north through the territory of Japan's ally Thailand. The Japanese swiftly captured airfields in northern Malaya and then began a quick advance down the peninsula. The Japanese had gained air and sea supremacy in the skies and seas off Malaya. On December 10th, two British battleships, the Prince of Wales and the Repulse, the only major naval forces Britain could muster, had been caught in daylight off the eastern Malaya coast by Japanese bombers based in Thailand and Vietnam. Time and time again in World War II, the battleship was shown to be the capital warship of the past, redundant, too vulnerable to air attack to survive. The two battleships were destroyed by a swarm of aircraft in just 2 hours. The Japanese wanted Malaya for its rich economic reserves, the tin mines, and the vast rubber plantations which were needed for Japan's war effort. The Japanese wanted to capture the giant British naval base on the southern tip of the Malay Peninsula on the island of Singapore, denying these facilities to their enemies, adding them as a base for further Japanese aggression. The Japanese advanced rapidly down the peninsula, capturing province after province. The British colony of Hong Kong was surrounded and besieged. Once again, the Japanese Air Force had destroyed the opposition swiftly at the start of the campaign, and then subjected the 8,000 defenders to constant bombing. 40,000 Japanese troops brought the British under constant pressure. In the expanse of the Pacific, conflict came to the distant archipelagos of tiny islands lying astride the strategic routes of war. On December 10th, the island of Guam fell to Japanese invasion. It and other small islands were intended to be fortresses in a ring of defenses around Japan's new empire. On the same day, Wake Island, held by just 400 Marines and 1,000 construction workers, was attacked by Japanese warships and taken 12 days later. Still, the wave of expansion went on. On December 15th, Japanese armies had invaded the British colony of Burma. The Japanese were attempting to cut supply lines to their nationalist Chinese enemies and to use Burma as a base for attacks on British India. In the very wildest of Axis dreams, Japanese armies marching into India were then met by German armies, which had swept eastwards from southern Russia and North Africa via Arabia and Iran. The wave of Japanese success revealed inherent tensions within the Axis alliance. It was an alliance of necessity rather than ideology. Hitler commented, half in despair, "The Japanese are occupying all the islands. They will get Australia. The white race will disappear from these regions." Japan did seek to drive the white colonial powers from Asia, appealing over the heads of European imperial masters to the indigenous populations. The army that attacked Burma, a state which had been independent of British rule within living memory, contained thousands of Japanese-trained Burmese nationalists fighting for their country's liberation. The rate of Japanese advance in those early days and weeks was astounding. Scarcely a day went by without some new attack begun or a new victory proclaimed. On December 23, 1941, Japanese troops invaded Borneo. The objective in Borneo, the British-controlled oil fields, again a crucial resource of war. On Christmas Day, Hong Kong fell. In a medieval move, the Japanese had cut the city's water supply. The new year brought no respite. On January 11th, the Dutch East Indies, modern-day Indonesia, was attacked by Japanese paratroopers. Again, the goal was oil reserves. On January 12th, the capital of Malaya, Kuala Lumpur, surrendered. In the Philippines, U.S. General Douglas MacArthur led a dogged defense of the Bataan Peninsula, into which the U.S. forces are gradually pinned by the Japanese. The morale amongst the U.S. forces is high, but MacArthur is told in secret that no relief column, no rescue fleet can be sent. Bataan has less than a month's starvation rations remaining. Throughout Australia, panic seized the population as the possibility of invasion, once seeming so remote for so distant a country, began to threaten. On January 24th, Japan invaded Australian-controlled New Guinea. They brought massive strength to bear and quickly overran the territory. In Malaya, the fighting drew to a climax. The Japanese forces had cleared the peninsula, and all British and Empire troops had withdrawn to the fortress of Singapore. Singapore was the mythology of the British Empire built into actuality. A trading city where Europeans could amass fortunes quickly. A center of maritime trade, a conduit for wealth, a huge naval base which harbored the ships of the Navy that bound the empire together with iron. That the British Empire was a maritime empire, one held together by a navy, was the downfall of Singapore. The assumption was that the city would be attacked by the navy of another European country. Singapore had mighty defenses, powerful guns, all pointed to the south, to the sea. The Japanese came from the north, overland. Winston Churchill saw the defense of Singapore in dramatic terms. He signaled to the British commanders, battle must be fought to the bitter end. Commander and senior officers should die with the troops. The honor of the British Empire is at stake. Despite sitting atop a massive arsenal of ammunition, 130,000 did surrender. The Japanese had cut water supplies and subjected the city to constant air bombardment. The lives of 1 million civilians were at risk. General Arthur Percival led the greatest surrender in British military history. 14,000 Australians, 16,000 British, and 32,000 Indian soldiers were marched into captivity. Japanese General Yamashita achieved the victory with less than 2,000 casualties. It was the climax to a brilliant campaign. The Japanese cloaked their invasion in the language of anti-imperialism. Indeed, this produced a reaction from the British. Expressly against Churchill's wishes, the British government, under pressure from America, offered India the same status within the British Empire as Australia or Canada. The offer was made conditional upon Indian support for the war. Of the more than 32,000 Indians who surrendered to the Japanese at Singapore, many were to join the Indian National Army, led by Indian revolutionaries. The INA was to fight alongside the Japanese Army against the British Empire. The outbreak of war between America and Japan brought deep and profound changes for the Japanese American citizens of the United States. For those of the second generation, the Nisei, born and raised in the USA, the war was to be a major test of the degree to which these Americans were truly assimilated. In March 1942, more than 110,000 Japanese Americans living on the west coast of America were forced to move, abandoning businesses and homes. On February 10th, 1942, the fear which had spread through Australian society was shown to have a basis in reality, not rumor. A powerful aircraft carrier force arrived in the waters off northern Australia and attacked the northern Australian city and port of Darwin. Once again, surprise was complete and Japanese losses limited to a single plane. The devastating raid, designed to disrupt any support that might have been given to resist the invasion of the Dutch East Indies, caused a general panic as military and civilians fled into the interior of the country. The East Indies were the richest territories in the Dutch colonial empire, a seventh of the income of the Netherlands economy coming from this one province. For Japan, the Dutch colony was a prize of great value. Besides oil and coal, the area produced rubber, nickel, and timber, and was important agriculturally as a major source of rice, sugar, and tea. The Japanese saw the need to seize the islands quickly before any scorched earth policy could be implemented, and used maximum force possible, invading at many places simultaneously. As elsewhere in Asia, the Japanese invaders were at first welcomed by the native population as liberators, but soon they came to act as a replacement and harsher colonial regime. A combined Dutch, British, American, and Australian fleet attempted to intercept a Japanese invading fleet, but was completely destroyed. Following Pearl Harbor, President Franklin Roosevelt urged the U.S. command to find some way to retaliate, to strike back against the enemy. the balance of power in the Pacific immediately following Pearl Harbor meant that it would be difficult for an aircraft carrier to safely approach Japan, to come within a range at which carrier aircraft could strike. A daring and ingenious plan was formulated. 16 Army Air Force bombers were placed on board the aircraft carrier Hornet. Launched more than 700 miles from Tokyo, the bombers had the range to reach Japan. They could not return to the carrier and had instead to fly on to airfields in China. Single bombers attacked naval dockyards and a force of 12 bombed Tokyo. The Doolittle Raid, as it came to be known, named after the Army Air Force colonel who planned and trained the volunteer crews, had an impact on the Japanese far over and above the material effect of the attacks. The raid on Tokyo killed just 50 people and damaged 100 houses, but no U.S. planes were lost over Japan. Some crew members who had to bail out over China were executed as war criminals by Japanese occupying forces. U.S. morale was raised by the news that something was being done. The raid's greatest effect was upon the Japanese high command and government. The military government had boasted that Japan would never be attacked. The shock of bombs falling so close to the emperor caused panicked overreaction, a surge of aggressive desire to bring the war to an end with victory. The 6 months to run wild in the Pacific that had been won by the attack on Pearl Harbor were nearing their end. The strategic bombing raid is a persistent element of the iconography of the war. A mass raid by a multitude of planes filling the sky, not the precision strike, so-called surgical strike by smart weapons, simply the saturation of a target, a factory, a port, a railway junction, or perhaps just civilian housing in an act of terrorism. Attacks intended to intimidate, to cow, to cause panic, to simply render homeless vast numbers of the enemy's people. An attack aimed to undermine the enemy's government by showing it unable to protect its own. An assault by thousands of bombs descending in clouds of death. Before the war, much had been predicted of air power as the means to win wars quickly. World War II was to show this theory was not so easily put into practice. 1942 saw the tactics of aerial bombardment develop in technology, in extent, and in ruthlessness. On March 29th, the RAF made an attack upon the German town of Lübeck, a town where factories made the engines for U-boats. Lübeck was also one of those small towns which adorn the continent of Europe, time capsules of architecture and of history, of living culture. It was destroyed, bombed, and burned flat, its medieval buildings succumbing with terrifying ease to the RAF. Nazi ideology was a theory of history that valued culture. In fury at the destruction of the German town, the German leadership ordered revenge. In an episode of war that was to border on black comedy, the German command used the Baedeker Guide, a tourist book describing the beautiful and historic sites of Europe, to select their targets. A series of raids were made against targets of nothing more than cultural value. The raids were not large, not particularly devastating. But the Baedeker Blitz, as it came to be known, was a further abandonment of the old-fashioned rules of war, what one side could and could not perpetrate against the other. After the fall of France, there were very few ways in which Britain could strike back at Germany. The bomber offensive was one of the few initiatives Britain could take. The lessons of the Battle of Britain and the Blitz seemed to show daytime raids simply too costly to both crews and aircraft. High losses meant that the attacks were switched to the night, where darkness gave such protection to the attacker that losses were minimized. The darkness also meant that attacks on a target as comparatively small as, say, an individual factory were impossible. The RAF's high command realized that the only alternative to abandoning the offensive was to target cities in mass attacks. Tactical necessity was turned into a strategic virtue. The policy of city center raids was to become the center of controversy for years to come. In May 1942, the RAF gathered together every element of its bomber's strength, combining frontline forces with all the reserves and training planes available to launch 1,000 aircraft against a single target, Cologne, causing massive damage. The successes of the first 1,000 plane attacks was not repeated, as the concentration on one target meant that defense could similarly be concentrated. Strategic bombing developed to the advantage of the Allies and against the Axis. The planes with which both sides began the war were in general medium-sized and twin-engined. In the spring of 1942, the first four-engine bombers, much larger and more powerful aircraft, appeared in the skies over Germany. That Germany never developed a large bomber was a significant failure. The British Lancaster bomber and the American B-17 and B-24 were capable of carrying heavy loads that were to devastate enemy cities. The prisoner of war is a constantly recurring figure in the mythology of World War II. The POW camp, a fertile ground for the imagination of the professional storyteller, with tales of endurance and sacrifice, plus incredible, impossible ingenuity. The 150,000 British Empire troops who surrendered at Singapore were just a fraction of the 10 million soldiers, sailors, and airmen who were to fall into the captivity of their enemy during the war. The treatment of the prisoners of war was governed by the Hague Convention of 1907, which declared that men who had laid down their arms should be treated decently. The Geneva Convention of 1929 laid down detailed rules for the treatment of prisoners. Under the convention, the POW was to be removed from the battlefield as soon as possible, if wounded, treated, fed, and housed to the same standard as the captor country's own soldiers, allowed to correspond with their families, and famously entitled to refuse all information except name, rank, and number. The conditions of POWs were to be inspected by the International Red Cross. If captured escaping, a POW was to suffer no more than a month's solitary confinement, the legendary 30 days in the cooler. The Geneva Convention was not acknowledged by either Japan or the Soviet Union. Stalinist communism refused to accept that any Soviet soldier would surrender. Historically, the capture of an officer was a cause of dishonor. But by the time of World War II, the nature of war, the huge scale of fighting, the advent of air forces, had caused a realization that capture might befall even the most honorable. No one foresaw the scale of the POW problem that was to arise in World War II. So utter was the collapse of Poland and France that Germany found itself with more than 2 million POWs by 1940. All sides in the war lost large numbers. 5 million Soviet soldiers were captured. Italians surrendered to the British in vast numbers. The fates which befell the prisoners of different armies varied widely. The Waffen-SS, the armed SS specialist units drawn from fanatical Nazis, rarely gave or asked for quarter. In some areas of Germany, British and American aircrew were lynched in mob vengeance. Soviet prisoners falling into German hands were treated with what amounted to savagery. Nearly 80% died in captivity. The Germans claimed not to be bound by the Geneva Convention, as the USSR had not signed. Russian officers were shot. Ordinary soldiers were left without food or shelter. Nazi racial theory held that Anglo-Saxons, British and Americans, were Aryan and deserving of respect. Slav soldiers were believed subhuman. In Asia, a different regime prevailed. The Japanese regarded surrender as irredeemable dishonor. Surrender of uninjured Japanese was almost unknown, and they despised the soldiers they took prisoner following Singapore's fall, as well as the captured Dutch from the conquest of the East Indies. No attempt was made to provide humane treatment. A minimum of food and shelter was supplied, in addition to intensive hard labor. In the dark hierarchy of race hate expounded by Nazi ideology, paramount above the hate of Slavic peoples was the hatred for the Jews. Jews had been persecuted in Germany since the Nazis had first come to power. In the occupied territories of Eastern Europe in the wake of the war, the Nazi racial ideology was played out to its logical and horrific conclusion. Jews in Poland had been forced into ghettos and into special labor camps. On June 1, 1942, a Polish underground newspaper, published in defiance of the occupation, printed rumors of systematic killings within these camps. Stalin thought the Germans would once more attack Moscow. Instead, Hitler aimed at the destruction of Soviet troops and the capture of the southern Russian industrial region, including the vital strategic resource of the Caucasus oil fields. In a renewed offensive, German armies swept south. Once again, vast advances were made, huge numbers of prisoners taken. Whole Russian armies fled en route. German attacks advanced through fleeing Russians, running in panic. Russian soldiers ordered to attack simply got out of their tanks and ran. For the first and only time in the war, Stalin ordered a strategic retreat. The key point for this campaign was the city of Stalingrad. The capture of this city on a major bend of the River Don would give the Germans a powerful strategic position, thrusting down southwards to dominate and roll up all of southern Russia, or to stab northwards at Moscow. Stalin had been a political commissar during the Russian Civil War in the 1920s. He had been stationed at the city that now bore his name and appreciated the importance of the city. As the Nazi armies drove even closer to Stalingrad, Stalin reinforced his armies there, making the city a decisive battleground. With the entry of the United States into the war, the Battle of the Atlantic, the War of Supply, fought against German U-boats, assumed even greater importance. Yet all the lessons of dealing with U-boats learned by the British Navy had to be slowly relearned by the US Navy. The Americans did not introduce convoys in American waters. In what the Kriegsmarine, the German Navy, came to call the second happy time, German U-boats sank huge numbers of unescorted merchant ships, many in U.S. coastal waters. Many of them tankers, carrying oil from the southern U.S. and the Caribbean. The ships sailing up the coast were silhouetted by the lights of U.S. towns and cities, not blacked out. They presented easy targets to hardened and experienced German submariners. The most ferocious and bitter fighting at sea was in this war of supply, the attack and defense of convoys. The most vicious fighting in this battle took place in the convoys to the Soviet Union. These sailed from ports in Britain and Iceland through the icy Arctic waters of the Norwegian and Barents Seas. Close to German-occupied territory, and in winter forced even closer to the Norwegian coast by icebergs, the convoys had to sail under constant attack and suffered the highest losses of any Allied shipping in the war. The ships carried goods of all sorts. The supplies of American trucks, of telephones, and even of boots were vital in helping the Soviet Union repel the German attacks of 1942. At first, the Allied ships sailed unmolested, a product of German confidence that Operation Barbarossa would be successful. As this confidence faded, the importance of this supply route grew in German eyes. Attacks came from U-boats, destroyers, and aircraft based in Norway. Even on occasions, German battleships broke out with cruiser support, mounting attacks in fleet formation. In one terrible action, a convoy was ordered to scatter in the face of attack by a German battleship force. Individual ships were then picked off by submarines and aircraft. In this one action, 2,500 aircraft, an entire air force, and nearly 500 tanks were sent to the bottom of the sea. It was not until nearly the end of the Cold War that the Soviet historians came to acknowledge the sacrifice of British and American seamen and the role of the supplies they carried. The British admirals pleaded that the convoys were expensive in manpower and shipping. But within the anti-Nazi alliance, the Grand Alliance, as Churchill came to name it, the Arctic convoys were the only answer to Stalin's demands that Britain open another front to relieve the pressure on Russia. Within the alliance, Churchill was under great pressure to act. The Americans underestimated the resources and general difficulty of acting against Nazi Germany. British communists, under orders from Moscow, switched from preaching defeatism to demanding that Britain act in the West. Churchill always preferred the indirect strategy and wanted to defeat the Axis in North Africa and then spread the war to Italy, attacking what he called the soft underbelly of the Axis. On April 10th, Great Britain gave its highest award for civilian bravery, the George Cross, to the entire island of Malta. No part of British territory throughout the entire war endured such regular and heavy attacks as the Mediterranean colony. In the first 4 months of 1942, Malta had suffered no less than 1,000 air attacks. The civilian population became a nation of cave dwellers, digging deep into the island's limestone. The constant air attacks were just part of a siege which the Axis extended around Malta. The planes flew from Sicily, a mere 160 kilometers across the sea. They bombarded the island itself and any shipping that attempted to bring supplies to the beleaguered defenders. The attacks were so fierce that the only vessels capable of making the voyage were submarines. The passage of some convoys grew into full naval battles, drawing in the Italian fleet. The defense of the island was to be the product of constant and repeated acts of daring. The siege was a battle fought to a medieval script, where starvation and disease were the weapons of the besieger. A typhoid epidemic swept throughout the population, who were surviving on as little as 1,500 calories per adult per day. Malta was a prize worth having to both sides. She sat astride the short sea routes to North Africa, and unless captured and in Axis hands, could threaten disaster to the Axis armies fighting in the desert. In North Africa, new supplies had enabled Germany's Africa Corps to bounce back from a British offensive of the previous year. Once more with inspired leadership from Rommel, the front moved back hundreds of miles across Libya. In what was now named the British Eighth Army, there was a panicked rout with men fleeing for survival. The retaking of airfields by the Germans in Libya tightened the siege of Malta and aided the supply of the Africa Corps. In a renewed offensive, the Africa Corps attacked and retook the strategically important port of Tobruk. This latest failure of the British, a defeat despite clear intelligence from codebreakers that German attack was coming, resulted in the dismissal of yet another British general. Lieutenant General Ritchie, commander of the 8th Army, was sacked. The commander-in-chief in the Middle East, Auchinleck, took command of the army himself. Tobruk's fall yielded the Germans 35,000 British prisoners and brought about a crisis in Britain. Secret opinion polls showed more than half the British people dissatisfied with Churchill's leadership and thought the war badly directed. Churchill had to face a vote of confidence in Parliament. 476 members voted in support, but 25 voted against, and 30 British MPs abstained. The Germans pushed into Egypt. Soon they would be within 100 kilometers of the crucial port of Alexandria, within reach of cutting the Suez Canal, striking at the Middle East oil fields, of winning the war. After the enormous tactical victory of Pearl Harbor, sane heads in the Japanese high command had warned that the forces of the Empire had only a little time in which to win victory. In May 1942, 6 months following Pearl Harbor, Japan mounted an invasion of Port Moresby in Papua New Guinea. Their aim was to extend their control so as to isolate Australia from the rest of her allies, to bring Australia easily within reach of Japanese aircraft. A Japanese invasion force that comprised of troop transporters, heavy warships, and 3 aircraft carriers was met by the American Navy with 2 carriers, plus an Anglo-Australian fleet. Once again, warning of the Japanese attack came through intelligence gathered by codebreakers. The battle fought between the two forces was to be known as the Battle of the Coral Sea. This was the first naval action in history that was fought carrier to carrier. The first in which 2 opposing navies never even sighted each other. Fighting that lasted 4 days, the two sides fought to a stalemate. 1 Japanese aircraft carrier was sunk. 1 American carrier so badly damaged that she had to be scuttled. Of the 2 other Japanese carriers, 1 lost so many aircraft, her strike power was heavily depleted. The other carrier so badly damaged as to be out of action for the coming months. Once again, the battle was a tactical success for Japan, but a strategic failure. New Guinea was not conquered, and the strategic goal to threaten Australia unattained. That such losses were inflicted on Japan's hard-to-replace ships, planes, and trained pilots would be crucially significant when the 2 navies next met. Battleships were no longer the major weapon of naval warfare, no longer a weapon which could destroy the enemy's main fleet. Battleships were still a threat. If such a warship fell among a convoy of merchant ships, or if a battleship were brought to bombard shore targets, provided there was no threat of air attack, the big gun ship could wreak terrible damage. Otherwise, the battleship on both sides were little more than prestige propaganda targets. Threats only, in that admirals in the opposing navies believed battleships a threat. In February 1942, three large German ships, the battlecruisers Scharnhorst, Wiesnau, and the cruiser Prince Eugen, daringly dashed up the English Channel under the noses of the British. The German action, though daring, was still a run for cover. In the vast spaces of Russia, the greatest battles of the war continued as the Soviet Union defended itself against German invasion. The German-Soviet conflict dominates World War II in terms of the vast distances, the huge numbers of forces involved. Every other campaign is dwarfed. In the first 6 months of Operation Barbarossa, when German troops have made deep and dramatic thrusts into the USSR, taking millions of prisoners, vast areas of the Soviet Union came under Nazi control. In many areas, the German troops were welcomed as liberators from Stalinism. This attack had been halted by desperate counterattacks in the snows of winter as the last Russian reserves were thrown into action. Through the winter months of 1942, Stalin had ordered attacks everywhere. Russian soldiers attacked a German army, then unprepared for winter fighting, and their attacks met with success. The German army had cautiously avoided major actions and allowed the Soviets to push west, stretching communication lines and draining large numbers of troops into vulnerable positions. When the Russian summer returned, the German army went once more on the offensive. The mathematics of the war were shifting slowly against the Germans. In early summer, the Red Army had 5.5 million soldiers deployed. The Germans just under 5 million, of which 400,000 were Finns, and just under 1 million were Axis allies, a mixture of Italians, Hungarians, Romanians, and even a division of Spanish volunteers. The crucial German advantages of better equipment, better training, and better leadership were being slowly eroded by the support of Britain and America. As Russia's quantity of forces became comparable in quality, the balance was to slowly tip against the Nazis. Barely a month after the Battle of the Coral Sea, and little more than 6 months after Pearl Harbor, a truly decisive battle of the Pacific War would be fought. The Japanese High Command resolved to end the war, to win a victory that would knock the United States out of the war. The Japanese plan was based on classic naval strategy, aiming to force the U.S. Navy into battle on Japanese terms. The plan was to attack the U.S. island of Midway. Midway was the furthest west U.S.-held territory in the Pacific. The attack would lure the U.S. Pacific Fleet into a battle which would bring about its destruction. Japanese Admiral Yamamoto planned to make the Americans weaken their defenses by making a feint towards the American Aleutian Islands, far to the north. Yamamoto believed that following this victory, the invasion and Japanese occupation of Hawaii would follow. This, in turn, would enable the Japanese Navy to drive the U.S. fleet from the ocean, even for Japanese forces to directly threaten the west coast of the continental United States. America would, as a result, sue for peace. The Japanese admiral's plan involved the concentration of a massive fleet, 145 ships strong. Once again, the work of the codebreaker was to be crucial. The breaking of the Japanese codes revealed that the Aleutian attack was a sham, and Midway the real target. The American Navy was therefore able to concentrate its defenses. Nevertheless, the material advantage lay with the Japanese, 4 carriers to the U.S. Navy's 3, 261 planes of the highest quality against a mixed bag of 230 U.S. aircraft. The Japanese force also contained 5 heavily armed, powerful battleships. The Japanese made several errors, which were to have a disastrous outcome. Photo reconnaissance of Pearl Harbor, which would have shown the base empty, was canceled. A screen of submarines was deployed to the east of Midway Island, too late, after the U.S. fleet had already passed through. Yamamoto expected his powerful fleet of four carriers to easily take the island. He expected, then, a weak, divided enemy, diverted by his northern dummy attack. Instead, he was entering a battle where the initiative, the surprise, actually lay with the United States Navy. The heart of the Japanese Navy, the aircraft carriers, supported by a small fleet of both smaller warships and battleships, with invasion forces aboard, sailed for Midway. The Japanese plan was complex and intricate, yet lacked in crucial details. Incredibly, Japan was misled by false intelligence into an American deception that a carrier, the USS Yorktown, had sunk following the Battle of the Coral Sea. Knowing the Japanese plans, the United States Navy made a series of false signals that implied what Yamamoto believed to be the last two remaining U.S. carriers, Enterprise and Hornet, were nowhere near Midway. In fact, they were there, ready and waiting, preparing a surprise attack of their own with the third totally unexpected carrier, the supposed sunk Yorktown. The American defense was everything, then, that the U.S. Navy could muster. All three operational aircraft carriers the U.S. Navy could put to sea. Midway was a perilously close-run battle. Through a combination of daring, gamble, luck, and inspiration, the U.S. aircraft caught the Japanese carriers by surprise. The Japanese approached Midway Island and made their first attacks, unaware that the U.S. Navy had such a powerful force in hand. United States admirals, overconfidence by the Japanese commanders, resulted in the Japanese carriers caught with their planes on deck, refueling and rearming. American bombers made a series of devastating attacks. Three Japanese carriers were destroyed in minutes. The fourth carrier attacked and severely damaged a U.S. carrier before herself being destroyed in another American attack. The U.S. Navy had torn the heart from its opponent. Never again would Japan be able to fight with a numerical advantage over the Americans. The war between America and Japan was only 6 months old. It still had over 3 years to run. Yet, already, it could be said to be moving to the end game. The Battle of Midway was a decisive day in the Pacific War. Within the space of hours, the balance of power had shifted against the Japanese. American industry could easily replace the lost aircraft and the lost ships, but Japan could not. Its force of skilled pilots and crews were lost to a man. Japan would never regain the initiative. The long march to defeat and surrender for Japan had begun. Next time on World War II, The Complete History, the Africa Corps broadcast to Egypt. They tell the ladies of Cairo, be ready for us tonight. This is a date the Africa Corps break as the British Army fight the Germans to a standstill at El Alamein. In yet another change of British commander, a newly appointed general is sent to lead the 8th Army in the desert. General Richard Gott takes command and on his first day is killed. A hurried search for a replacement throws up a stand-in who will march into history. The second choice, General Bernard Montgomery, steps in to lead the British Empire forces and creates a legend to match that of his opponent, Erwin Rommel. The day after Montgomery takes command, the German army comes before Stalingrad and the decisive battle of the European War begins. In the West, British and Canadian forces carry the war to the Germans as a powerful raid is mounted on Dieppe. It is a defeat for the Allies, but vital lessons are learnt. Montgomery shatters the myth of Rommel at the Second Battle of El Alamein. It's a stunning victory, which Churchill calls the end of the beginning. America goes on the offensive. Guadalcanal is recaptured from the Japanese. American forces land in North Africa and meet an army of the Third Reich for the first time. The skies of Germany begin to fill with the planes of the United States Air Force. At a meeting of Roosevelt and Churchill, the ultimate war aim is spelled out to Nazism. It is to be unconditional surrender.